Ladies and gentlemen, here we are with the dynamic duos, Maurice Ray Smith at Hollywood Times, father and daughter, and they look so much alike. I knew they were biologically linked as soon as I saw him, and then she was hovering and had the same look, the same jaw.
I mean, she doesn't have the scruff, but...
Yeah, she doesn't have the scrub, but she's got the bone marrow thing going on. How's it going tonight?
It's going great. Thank you for having.
Yeah. Now, your name is, I think you told me.
I'm Jonathan Dane. This is my daughter, Lauren Stuckey.
Hi. Are you both in the film?
No. I'm in the film. She's here to support.
Oh, cool.
Because well, you couldn't take anyone else.
Huh?
You couldn't take anyone else.
You were my first choice as a date.
No, I volunteered.
Okay, fine. Date night.
Which films have you been in that we could check you out in?
I haven't been in any, but I've been in some JCPenney commercials.
Oh yeah, that's cool. That's work. How long ago has that been?
The JCPenney was last year.
A couple years ago?
No, not a couple years ago. It was last year, and then you shot a couple other small projects too.
Well, that's cool. You're a working actress. A lot of people are not working. So you ought to be very proud of yourself, yeah.
Wow.
And you are in this film, and which you're well in the film?
I'm Julian. I'm the wedding planner. So I come in to help make sure all of this craziness that's ensuing comes together, and we hit the final day, and everything gets off without a hitch.
Cool. Now, you mentioned craziness. I heard about a chase scene. Are you in the chase scene?
I am part of the chase scene. I'm in one of the chase vehicles you'll get to see. So I am in it and a part of helping everything come together and being a part of this wonderful couple.
Very cool. Now, are there any upcoming projects you'd like to tell us about we could boost for you right now?
Oh, that's very cool of you. I'm actually up for a sci-fi film right now.
Ooh.
And so it's a feature film that's really fun. It's kind of iRobot meets Ex Machina.
Okay.
So we'll see what happens with that. And then as for anything in TV and film other than that, this is the thing I'm most excited about right now, and so I'm really here just to support.
Well, I can feel the energy. I can tell that you guys know how to act, but you know how to synergize that energy.
Because you
can feel it. You know,
well, that's very kind.
When you can feel it, then it's worth watching, because you can feel it. If you know what I mean? You can just tell if people feel enough about each other to make it real, even though it's totally false. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you make it as real as you can. I mean, that's the whole purpose of it.
Right.
Know?
But I mean, some people, the stuff I turn on, I know they can act. They're on there. But I just don't feel it. So I'm like, okay,
right. Next.
Let's hit the old remote here. You know, and just keep looking and looking, you know. But I can feel this happening. Now, how can we reach you on social media?
The best way to reach me would be on Instagram, and I would say that's at Jonathan Does Things.
Okay.
And that's probably Instagram.
I really don't do much social, but at Jonathan Dane would be the best way to find me.
Okay.
The easiest way to find him is to search on Google and then click on his things.
Well, that's true too.
Yeah,
and then she hasn't.
She's not on.
She has.
Social?
Yeah, no, we don't have her on social right now.
Okay, that's probably cool.
Yeah,
because there are some psychopaths out there.
There are some. There's some interesting folks, and you know, we just want to keep it safe for the little ones.
Yeah, keep it locked down. Cool.
Sure.
I just want to thank you both for
thank
coming,
you.
Speaking to me, sharing that wealth of love. You know, as they say, where's the love? Here it is, right here, father
right.
and daughter. It's very cool. So I wish you continued success.
Thank you.
And get that sci-fi thing going on. Keep making those commercials until you get the big break. And you have a great night.
Thanks
Thank
so you. Much. You too.
Ladies and gentlemen, Maurice Gray Smith again. And we're here on the red carpet with this beautiful actress.
Thank you.
How are you doing today?
Hi.
Tell us who you are and what you're doing.
I am Lisa Cole, and I play Wanda in Fathers of the Bride here that we're going to see tonight. I'm very excited.
Yeah, I'm very excited for you. What does Wanda do?
Wanda is she's the secretary at their office of the family's business, but she also is very wise and knows what needs to happen to bring everybody to happiness.
She's the glue of the family.
Yes.
And like, is she like where everybody tends to meet up? Families come to her house for holiday meetings?
Well, a little bit more behind the scenes than that. They don't even realize that she's, you know, making things right for them.
Okay. So she's like the shadow. She's like the shadow nose, kind of like.
Yeah.
Now, what's your real name? I'm sure you told me, but I'm bad.
My name is Lisa Cole.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Now, are there any projects you'd like to talk about? Tell us any future projects.
I just finished a great guest star on a really popular network, long-running television show that I can't really name just yet.
Uh-oh.
But that was super fun. They have been on the air for a long time, so it's just like boom, 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 boom. Well-oiled machine
right.
over there.
I don't want to start going through all the long runnings because that would put you on the spot.
Yeah.
I have an idea who it is, though.
Yeah. And I've been getting lucky. It's still a little slow right now in the industry, but I've been getting some good auditions. And then I went away to Europe for a couple of weeks, so that slowed me down for a little bit. And I had never been, and it was amazing.
Yeah, where in Europe did you go?
Well, actually, just the UK so far. We went to London and Edinburgh.
Oh, cool.
And it was pretty special.
Very cool. Now, how about past work? Would you like to tell us any of your past work? We can check you out there as well.
Yeah. Right now, you can catch me streaming on Apple Plus's The Last Thing He Told Me with Jennifer Garner.
Okay.
Truth Be Told, which is an Octavia Spencer show.
Okay.
I'm in an episode of that.
Okay. Is that also on Apple?
What's that?
That also on Apple?
That's also on Apple, yes.
Okay.
And then on Hulu, Reasonable Doubt.
That sounds very familiar.
Courtroom drama.
Okay, that sounds very familiar. I think I might be watching that.
And I have done many 9 or 10 to other television movies that are streaming at any given time.
Now, how can we find you on social media so we can punch you down?
Lisa Cole Actor at Instagram and on. Are people still using Facebook?
Yeah.
Okay. Lisa Cole McClure, because I'm married there on Facebook.
Okay. Cool.
And I'm also on TikTok. I kind of am just a lurker on TikTok. But every once in a while, I'll post something because mm-hmm. those people are entertaining over there on TikTok.
Yeah. What about Twitter?
I left them because, you know.
Seems kind of combustible.
Yeah. I didn't need that much stress in my life.
Well, I just want to thank you so much for being Wanda.
Thank you. It was really nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too. And I hope you have continued success.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
You too.
Bye-bye. Boom, and ladies and gentlemen, here we are, Maurice Strange Smith, Hollywood Times, on the scene with the married couple in the movie of Father the Bride. And there they are. Who wants to go first? I don't want to cause any strife within the marriage. No favoritism. So
there's always favoritism.
So we'll go with Gary first. Of course.
Yeah, my sister.
I'm kind of the favorite.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which, it's because of my job. I play a cop. So naturally.
What's your name in the movie?
Ruben.
Ruben. Yeah. And what's your real name?
Mark Prince.
Mark. Okay. Now you're a cop in the movie.
Yes.
And you are Gary in the movie, right?
I am Gary Matthew in real life, and in the movie my name is Ed, and I am the supportive husband of Mark.
Of your character. Of the po-po named Ruben. Now he's going to lock you up for non-compliance.
Yes, I know. We shot this movie so long ago. I forgot my own character's name.
So now, did you know each other before this movie?
No, we didn't. But we really hit it off. Like, the casting was great because it really worked with us.
Yeah.
I mean, our energies just kind of intertwined, and now we're great buds.
Okay, machine as well, right out of the gate. I don't know, I was just saying earlier how when we get together, you know, every here and there, it's kind of like a reunion, but we never left the set.
Right. Everything just back to normal. I mean, from even before we were shooting, we were rehearsing together, and it was just, it was a match. It was like two friends just clicking.
The experience was great.
So cool. I can't ask for anything more than that.
Were you two involved in the chase scene in the movie?
Which intimidates me when I read
that. That'd be me. I was the driver of the lovely police car that chases down.
No, Bruce called me one day.
Sounds funny.
And I love you.
Now, so you guys shot a lot of Thousand Oaks, right?
Yeah. Thousand Oaks. We had a couple locations. We had our house, and then we had another house, their house, and then for the wedding, and then for another scene we had was at the restaurant. So you see in the and restaurant. Then that's when we're all romantic and lovey and affectionate.
It's worked for me in
so,
the
years. So it's all a combination of comedic, maybe a couple of arguments, or just straight comedic harmony.
We had a good relationship. Yeah. We were supportive friends to the problematic relationship, so to speak.
Yeah. I mean, we had our own thing going on with our love, and our anniversary was actually happening in the film as well.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, we were the great example of a voice on the
escalator. We were, actually. Say it with confidence. We were.
It was funny.
We were. Yeah.
But I mean, now, in real life, they're not really married together.
No, we're buddies.
Oh, okay. Well, let me tell you, I just want to thank you guys for bringing your great energy and your talent to this incredible film. But how can we find you on social media?
Oh, at GaryMatthew7 on Instagram. GaryMatthew7.
And now she's older.
And I'm at MarkKent1980 on Instagram.
I love her.
Okay. But now your real name is Ruben.
Harrison Carter. I love her.
My real name is Mark Prince.
And so,
okay. Now, are there any other projects like to tell us to keep our eyes open for?
Yeah, I just finished shooting a Netflix series last week. It's a Netflix original. It's a kids show called Blippi, and that'll come out next summer.
Cool. I'll be looking forward. I've started doing more on Netflix lately, and then I realized there's a lot of good stuff on Netflix. Like, whoa, all this is going down.
There is. They're picking up more and more projects. They're trying to stay ahead of the game. During Hollywood, it's kind of a slow time the past year and a half or so, and Netflix was kind of the first to start ramping it up with the work. So I'm super grateful for this last job that I did. I just finished shooting about a week ago, and like I said, it'll air next summer. Flippy.
I'll be looking forward to it. And how can we find you?
I'll be auditioning for a new agent near you.
Now, would you like to tell us any of your past works that we could also go back and find you?
I've been mostly a theater actor, based from Chicago, so I've only been in LA for about a year and a half.
Equity guy.
Yes, absolutely. The Uber Grand Cabaret Theater was the last place I worked outside of working this film, so I'm really just kind of rebuilt here.
Do you ever find some sort of conflict between the skills you learn as a stage actor and what's needed on the set?
Well, in stage acting, it's live, right? Like, there's no cuts. There's no breaks. I actually find film acting a bit easier because I get opportunities to redo that line, reshoot that scene, give myself a second shot. So, yeah, I wouldn't call it a conflict more than I would call it an opportunity.
Oh, cool. Okay. Because I thought I heard people say that when you're on stage, do things bigger, and when you come on the set, you have to bring it, tone it down or whatever.
Yeah, you got to tone it down for the screen, absolutely. But on stage, it's wide, bright. Luckily, I'm tall, so that works for me on stage. A little more difficult on screen, but that's okay. We can work around it.
Well, I just want to congratulate both of you for getting this great role.
I just have to say, I am so grateful that I got to work with Mark. Mark is one of the best actors that I know. He really is. And I think you have the theater to thank for that, right? But I mean, it was great working with Mark. And when he says, like, he's able to shoot multiple takes if he needed to, he didn't need to because he was always prepared. He was always on it. And it was, I appreciate that work and preparation that you put into it before the shoot. So that when we were shooting, you were with it. You were awesome.
And Gary is just okay.
Yeah.
No, just phenomenal actor, fantastic actor.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, congratulations on both of you. I hope this jettisons you, gives you more momentum for different roles. And thanks for taking your time out to talk to us.
Thank
you so much. Bye bye. Here we are with Bob, the young and thin producer, owner of the magical vibe tonight.
That's
are you the
right.
producer, sir?
No, I am Dr. Christmas. We did all the Christmas thing, set decor for the film, and we're also acting in the film too.
Oh, cool. What's your role in the film?
Well, it works. I play the Christmas decorator.
You just told me that. I'm like,
yes,
what
I am. I'm a good friend who's also a holiday planner. And Bruce, the producer of the film, actually hired me to do the set. And he said, I got this great role, and I know you used to be an actor. Would you like to do it? So I said, sure, it'll be fun to play myself, essentially.
Yeah,
so I might have to study for it.
Oh, cool. So now, are you also in the infamous chase scene as well?
A what?
Are you in the infamous chase scene?
Oh, no, I'm not in the chase scene. No. No, I'm the Joan Collins of the show. You know, I just come in when the cocktails are served, the barbs are thrown, and then sit down and make things pretty. No, I don't chase nothing.
Oh, cool, cool. So now, are you, kind of like related to anyone in the show?
I'm not related to anybody in the film. I'm just kind of one of the guys and the gang and the annoying friend who is always forcing these two to have a party.
So yeah. You're kind of like a stoner?
Not quite a stoner. I'm more like an uptight queen.
Okay. Now, what other projects do you have going on this year?
Well, you know, in addition to my decorating business, because, you know, I do a lot of celebrities in films. You know, we've done movies, everything from Elf, and we do a lot of films for Hallmark, and I get acting occasionally, and some of my celebrities like Kevin Hart and Beyonce and people like that are lovely people, and they've hired me in the past to do things for them.
That's amazing.
So it's... Yeah, it's a totally made-up career, and I didn't get out of bed one day and say, hey, I want to be a Christmas decorator. It just kind of, I came to L.A. to be an actor, and we had success in that, but I got hired by Paris Hilton's mother, Kathy Hilton, to work in her gift shop, and from there, she kind of pulled me aside and said, hey, you want to make it in this town? I'll watch me. And one of my claims to fame is that I was Paris Hilton's babysitter. And, you know, I'm still friends with Paris and her husband, Carter, and I love her. Now she's grown up, and I mean, she's older than I am now.
Wow. That's pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. Are you going to work on a memoir?
I'm sorry?
Are you going to do like a book about your life?
Well, you know, I have a book. Yeah, actually, believe it or not, a publisher thought my life was fascinating, which I never thought it was, but, you know, I've been in this town for a long time. I started in a little town called Sturgis, Michigan, and I ended up in Beyonce's living room and decorating for Carrie Fisher and things like that. Wow. And so people came to me and said, your life is kind of fascinating. So we're working on a book that... It's more about inspirational. I mean, it's nice that I have all these celebrity clients and things, but there are a lot of mentors along the way. And my hope with the book is that it inspires some other, maybe little kid from the Midwest who kind of didn't belong anywhere, that you too can go out and make things possible. And you never know what's going to happen to your life because you just keep going. I always say, just keep going.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's not been a straight line to success, you know, but it has been a really interesting journey along the way. And I met really cool people. Every one of them, famous and non-famous, have got me where I am today. And like this film, this just came out of the blue. I thought, you know, why not? Let's go do it. It'll be fun.
Cool. So not only are you grateful and humble, but you're giving out the good vibe. That's cool.
Well, you know, I've always been a big believer in Christmas, and you know, when I say that, I want people, my gift is actually creating a space for people to come together and enjoy, whether it's around a Christmas tree, whether it's going to a movie. It's about communication. It's about the gathering. You know, the decorations and everything are lovely, but they're not, you know, we don't need them to survive on this planet. They just kind of create the setting so that people can come to a really great place. Let's have a cocktail. Let's chat. Let's do whatever. But it's all about community with me, so.
Definitely. Well, I'm happy that you bring that type of vibe not only to the set, but into the world, because that kind of thing can just do like the domino thing. And just want to thank you for being who you are. Congratulations on your role. And how can we follow you on social media?
You can follow me on Dr. Christmas Hollywood on Instagram, Dr. Christmas on Facebook. Just go Dr. Christmas, you'll find me.
We will find you.
And that
you.
Is drchristmas.com.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Yeah. We will find you. I'm sure people will see this. And just keep being yourself, and thank you so much.
I'm having a great time, and I want people to have a good time with me.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Yep. Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Hi there, Maurice Strangsmith here with Patrick. How's it going, Patrick?
How you doing?
Now, Patrick, you're in the film. I've heard you're not in the film, but you're a cyber winner. Is that correct?
I'm a what?
I heard you're a winner of...
Oh, we won a SAG award for Glee. back in the day, yeah.
Okay. I thought he would say cyber. I was like, because you never know, SAG is with this brand new media. It might be a new category, cyber.
Yeah, I was nominated for a BAFTA award, a video game award for Gotham Con.
Oh, cool. That was something. What was your role in the SAG film?
Well, that was played Ken Tanaka in Glee, 2009, 2010, in the first season. So we luckily won the SAG Award for Best Ensemble.
Oh, good.
And then Kotin Khan was in Ghost of Tsushima in 2020.
Okay. I just want to thank you, congratulate you.
Thank
and,
you.
And would you like to tell us of any upcoming projects coming up this year?
Well, I'm lucky enough to be going back and reprising my role as Daiichi on Blue Eye Samurai. So okay. That will be coming out, I guess, in a year or two. I don't know how long it takes. It takes a long time to do animation. And I got a part on a show called I think it's called Wayward. They change the titles a lot. That's on Netflix.
Sounds familiar.
Play another cop. So,
sounds
play a lot of cops.
Yeah. I think I may have seen that. I've been streaming like wild lately.
Yeah, well, it hasn't been released yet. I think we're just finishing up. I'm going back, I think, next week to do one more episode.
Okay. So how can we reach you on social media?
I'm on Instagram at I am Patrick Gallagher.
Okay. And
you know what's neat? I'm holding a picture of my new daughter. So
oh, congratulations.
Thank you.
How old is she?
9 months last on the 23rd. So wow. She was born December 23rd. Yeah. Greatest thing ever.
So she's walking around?
Yeah, crawling and standing and babbling. And
getting into trouble, always got to keep your eye on her?
Yeah, she can stand up. She can stand up supported for a long time. So I think I'm probably going to go to a lot of soccer games as I get older.
Yeah. Sometimes they don't let you know all they can do, and all of a sudden, oh my God, I didn't know she could do that.
Yeah, that's the most amazing part of it, is just watching them grow every day. So.
Oh, cool. Well, congratulations on bringing the new bundle of joy into the world.
Thank you.
And we hope to be seeing you soon in that Blue Eyed Samurai.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I know they're recording it now, but I think it takes a while. So, I mean, I read somewhere it might be 2026. It takes a long time to do animation, but I don't know much more than that. I'm just happy to be back. It's such a great series to be a part of.
It sounds really cool. What's your whole name so we know how to find you?
My name is Patrick James Gallagher.
Very cool. I just want to thank you for your time and hope you have continued success and congratulations on your work and your new bundle of joy.
Thank you, and make sure everybody you vote.
Oh, definitely. Thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, Maurice Train Smith here with Amanda Gary. She's Mrs. Hillard in the movie.
Mrs. Hillard, yes.
Very cool. Just want to thank you for taking time out. I know it's a very splendid night.
Oh.
A lot of passion, a lot of fun and joy. And your baby's going to be hatched pretty soon.
Yay!
For mass consumption. How do you feel about tonight? And tell us who you are in the movie.
I'm Mrs. Hillard in the movie, and I couldn't be more excited to be here. I haven't seen the film yet, so it's as new to me as it is to you, and I can't wait.
Yeah. Now, you look extremely familiar. I'm sure I've seen you in other films. I'm pretty sure.
Well, the most recent thing would be the series Old Dogs and New Tricks, which is on Amazon Prime.
Very cool.
And we had four seasons, four wonderful seasons, and hopefully more.
Yeah, I'm sure it will be. You have a look that makes people want to look at you.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Now, are there any other projects coming up this year you'd like to tell us about?
Well, I am working on a one-woman show in the meantime, mm-hmm. and that also includes my tribute to the late, great Judy Garland.
Oh, okay, cool, yeah. She was a sparkling woman.
Oh, one of my very tip-top idols, yes.
Yeah, she was cool. So, just want to thank you for your time to come and talk to us.
Oh, of course.
How can we find you on social media?
I am on Instagram at catmanda14,
okay.
And you can look up me on YouTube under amandagary.com.
Okay.
I have a bunch of videos there. I know you'll enjoy.
I'm sure I will too. Well, I just want to congratulate you on your incredible success and keep doing what you're doing. It's working for
you.
Thank
you. My great pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Have a good night.
And here we are, Maurice Rainsmith again, with the producer, and he and his brother co-produced it, and he is the man on the hour right now, Father of the Bride. How are you doing, man?
I'm good. I directed the movie, my brother and I co-wrote it, and we co-produced it.
Wow. So it's a family affair. It's a movie about family.
That's
his family
right.
Started it, and it's very cool. How long has this movie been in the works?
Me? actually, the script goes way back when we first originally wrote it. We wrote a number of scripts during the lockdown, and we this one went through a number of iterations before we finally decided this is the one we wanted to produce. So actually, the script itself dates back a few years, but the latest version of it is more recent than that.
Wow. So was there any main reason why this movie popped up into you and your brother's horizon and you had to bring it to the big screen?
I think because we like the story so much. It's a comedy and it's a wedding Christmas movie. There have been a lot of those, but there's subtle themes in there that I don't think have ever been done before. The question of, you know, what constitutes a real family and, you know, having to work together with people that you may or may not be directly related with. I thought it was a story worth telling.
Oh, cool. Are you like a Stephen King? Do you put yourself in your movies as well?
I'm in it, but only involuntarily. We needed one extra in one scene, and you can see the corner of my hand holding the wine glass.
That's very cool. But what's your last name?
Hart.
And what's your brother's name?
He's Bruce Hart.
Oh, cool.
He is also in the movie. He plays one of the fathers.
Oh, cool. Very cool. Was there any problem during the chase scene?
No problem in terms of danger, but it was quite a lot of work to do. You know, we had this one sort of one area where we could shoot it. We had to keep going back and forth in that same area, and we'd run out at the end. So, okay, you know, turn around and come back.
That's always cool. I always know from, you know, experience that sometimes it might look like it's a small little segment of a film, but it might have taken 20, 30, maybe 40 takes, you know?
So, absolutely. That's absolutely true.
Where was the shot mostly?
When?
Where?
Oh, where? We shot in various locations, in various places that we... So I can't say it was shot in one place mostly. We shot at a house in Thousand Oaks. A lot of it was shot there.
Oh, okay.
So other scenes are just, you know, different. A lot of it was real locations we were shooting in, the apartment and the house and so on.
Oh, cool. Very cool. Now, I bet you're on IMDb. How can we find your IMDb and also on social media?
That's right.
So would that be the best place to find you? Social media, Twitter, Facebook?
I don't have a lot of social media presence, but I am on IMDb, and you can find the webpage of this movie. It's just fathersofthebride.com.
Okay.
That's out
Very
there.
Cool. Well, I just want to thank you so much. I applaud you, and it sounds like a great film.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, and hope you have continued success. Oh, by the way, what are some of the other projects that you have coming up this year?
We have a... I can't say we've got something specific coming out. We have another four scripts that we wrote during COVID, and we would love... They're all different genres. There's a kind of a funny... there's a kind of a comical horror movie. There's a farce. You know, they're all different things, and we'd love to make every one of them, but we'll see what happens.
Good. We'll be looking for them.
Thank you.
Congratulations on all your great work. And I hope you have continued success.
No, thank you so much.
Thank you, Paul.
Sure.
Here we are. This is Maurice Rainsmith again, and we're here with Rafaela, and she is in this movie, which will be a blockbuster, I'm sure.
Oh, thank you.
Energy is great.
Thank you so much. I'm Rafaela Dreyer. I play Angela in Fathers of the Bride. I play the meddling aunt that is a little bit over the top, a little bit extra, and I've been married multiple times, so she has the most experience to help plan this wedding, mm-hmm. to make it the most amazing event ever. And she kind of butts heads with my brother-in-law in the film, and that's where a little bit of the drama comes up.
Yeah, I've been watching. You have great, great, great energy, nice smile.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, so you kind of like the light. You bring people to you. They can feel your spirit.
Oh, yeah.
That's how it seems.
That's so nice. Thank you. Now, go ahead.
No, I'm sorry.
Oh, I was just going to say, as just an actor, I also love to go to concerts. I love rock concerts. I love to just, be out with people and everything. So I think maybe I try to absorb other people's energy to be a little bit extra, too.
Yeah. So, is your family, or is your husband, boyfriend, dad, mom here with you tonight?
My husband's here tonight, yes. Okay. So he hasn't seen the film. He's very excited, as I am too. And yeah, it's great. My family's in Texas, so unfortunately they couldn't be here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So now, how can we find a way to follow you this year and other projects?
Well, I'm on Instagram at Rafaela Dreyer, and I am actually in a new show that's going to be coming out on Real Short app called Summer Situationship.
Okay.
So you can follow them on Instagram as well, and that should be coming out in October.
Oh, cool, cool.
Yeah.
Now I can tell just by looking at you, you've done some modeling.
Oh, a little bit, and I'm tall. I'm almost 6 feet. So.
Oh, that's cool. How can we find you on the modeling circuit?
Well, I actually haven't really done anything lately, but you never know. I mean, there's a red carpet. Let's walk.
Yeah. What's your name in the movie?
My name is Angela.
Angela, cool.
Yes.
You probably told me that, but I was...
That's okay.
Kind of tripping a little, I guess.
No worries.
I just want to thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations on this great movie.
Oh, thank you so much.
And we'll be looking for any future projects that you have, and just want to wish you continued success.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much.
I appreciate it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Maurice Dwayne Smith here with Brooke.
Yay.
And she is the bride, and she is the pride of this movie. How's it going today?
It's going so well. I'm so excited to be here, honestly. We're already having a great time, so I'm excited. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was hearing about it's going to be a car chase and everything, trying to get you to... Be right.
Oh my gosh, the car chase. Yeah, we are just kind of like, this isn't right for us. Let's just get away. You'll see. You have to see. I don't want to like spoil it. But yeah, essentially there is like a little bit of a car chase. So I think it'll be super cool.
Yeah, it sounds very cool. Now, as far as you in regular real life.
Yes.
What is your real life name? Oh, I mean Brooke.
Yeah, Brooke's real life is great. I have a boyfriend. I'm not married yet. I have, my mom, my dad, who I love very much. They're here tonight, all three of them. And it's awesome. And I feel like as far as a resemblance between Michelle and Brooke goes, like, I feel like I'm so close to my dad's in the movie. That's exactly how it is with my parents. Like, we're so close. We share everything. They're my best friends. Yeah.
What's your name in the movie?
Michelle.
Michelle, okay. Now, how can we reach you in social media, Twitter,
yes,
all that good stuff?
You can go ahead and follow me on Instagram. It's just at Brooke St. John's, my full name.
Mm. Nice name, by the way.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, I think Instagram is like my biggest one right now. You know, my biggest social media that I use at the moment. Yeah.
Okay. Are there any other projects coming up that you want us to keep our eyes open for?
Yes, I actually just started a movie called Rush. It's a horror film.
Oh, I love it.
Directed by Abina Nazir, and it's going to be great. I'm in the beginning of the movie, so you'll see a little bit of me there.
Okay.
Yeah, and a couple other things are in the works right now, but we just are waiting on confirmation. So
cool. That's
the best.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for taking time away to talk to us. And
of course, I love it.
Oh, yeah, and I'd like to thank you and wish you much continued success.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
And ladies and gentlemen, hi there. We got one of the dads from Father of the Bride. We just spoke with one of them, Rich, and now we got the other partner in crime. And he's Leo. How's it going today?
Good, good. Thank you. Thanks
now, what's your real name, though?
My real name is Peter Schliga.
Oh, cool. Now, as Leo, what can we expect from you in this film?
You expect to see someone who's trying to balance family dynamics, trying to keep my sister and my husband happy at the same time, which is very, very difficult because they don't get along. So I'm trying to be the peacekeeper in this whole film, like trying to keep everybody happy. which is the difficult thing to do.
So I heard there's a car race or car chase.
There is a car chase. That was very fun to do. Driving after the daughter as she decides that she's not going to have the wedding. They're going to go elope. And we wanted her to have this wedding, so we're like chasing them in the car. We shot that like it was an entire day of shooting in a car.
Oh, wow. Wow. Sounds very cool.
It was.
I was wondering, could you tell us what we can expect to see from you in other upcoming projects this year?
I hope something good. Nothing on the books right now. I do a lot of casting also, so I've been casting some commercials and things like that. I cast a lot of athletic competition shows in my day. So let's hope an acting role comes along real soon, because that's where my heart lies. That's my favorite thing.
Well, stay true to your heart.
Thank you.
And could you tell us some of your acting? Would you like to talk about the different names of your acting
Yeah, it's funny. I met Bruce years ago, who is one of the producers of it, and his brother. And I did a play, like we're talking many, many years ago. And I've been in many plays with him. I did one last year in Long Beach at the Long Beach Playhouse.
Okay.
And then I've been in 3 films with him, actually. So This is our 3rd film together. And that's something I really appreciated. He's someone who is, like, very loyal in this business. And has brought me along the way when he's producing things, so I'm very grateful for that, giving me the opportunity to do what I love to do.
That's cool. Well, it sounds like it's working for you. It looks like it's working, and it
thank
is working.
You. Thank you.
So don't break the connection.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
And thanks so much for your time.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks.
I hope you have continued success.
Thanks.
You're very welcome.
All right.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Maurice Joy Smith here for Hollywood Times, and here for the screening of Father the Bride, and we're here with the lead. His daughter's going to be getting married. Is that right?
Yes, I'm Bruce Hart, and I am one of the 2 dads in Fathers of the Bride. And it's the tale of, actually, 2 dads that have been together forever. When marriage became legal for them, they just got married, right? But they raised Michelle.
Right.
Michelle's finally getting married. They're so excited. But Michelle does not want to have a wedding ceremony. And my character starts it out. I'm like, kind of, no, we'd be happy to pay for it. We slowly guilt she and her fiancé into having this wedding. And then what you see is all the stress and the angst that comes from planning a wedding. And you see a few buried family ugly secrets, including my sister-in-law in the film, who at one point finally reveals that she doesn't view me as actually really family. I know, right?
Sounds cool. Sounds like a lot of forest fires and bombs going on.
I think it's a fun film, and it's very comical. There's even a car chase. I think people are just going to love it.
Yeah, it sounds pretty cool. What else can we look forward to seeing you act in later this year?
Actually, this is the only thing I got going, but I have tons of stuff streaming. I'm on a TV series called Old Dogs and New Tricks. I'm on Where the Bears Are, Boys Town,
So you needed a break.
Exactly.
How can we find you on social media?
You can find me on Instagram, Bruce384, and also on Facebook, just Bruce Hart, H-A-R-T. And I'm not on Twitter or X.
Oh, okay. Well, I just want to thank you so much for taking time away to speak to us.
It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, hope you have continued success, and congratulations on this film.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, here we are with the beautiful Gabriella. How's it going, Gabriella?
Fantastic. Doing this well, one? Thank you.
Oh, good. Sorry to cut you off.
It's okay.
I took a couple pictures of you, which defied logic. As you saw, it looked like it was daytime, right?
It's our energy, baby. It's glowing.
So maybe it's the Marilyn Monroe coming out of you.
I think so. The spirit's coming out.
Yeah. So could you tell us any of your new projects?
I'm actually going to go to the Bay Area for about a month and a half. I have a feature and a short film.
Can you talk about it a little bit?
I can. One's a comedy, and the other one's like a drama family situation. That's all I can say.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Are you going to start doing projects where you're the main director and producer?
In the future, I'd love to produce, yes.
What kind of projects might there be? Might there be romance? Might there be horror? Might there be action?
I would do like a indie drama, docu-style, a couple of shorts. I really want to, being a Mexican-American, I want to focus more like on Latinx voices.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about music? Are you into music yet?
I'm a music lover. I was listening to Donna Summer on the way over here and Grace Jones.
Are you doing anything, you know, actually yourself, singing or
producing? I sing in my car, except I just put the volume up. Yeah, no producing. No. Just, yeah, I'm an artist.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I just want to thank you for your time.
Thank you.
If people wanted to find you on social media, how can they find you?
Instagram, it's my first and last name, and beauty, so it's Gabriela with one L, Aceves, A-C-E-V-E-S, so it's Gabriela Aceves Beauty.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful evening.
Can I get a quick, what do you call it, selfie with you?
Yeah.
Okay. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, we have the honor of being here with a guy, to me, looks like a young Marlon Brando in a way.
Thank you very
probably
much.
Heard that before?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah, and your movie was quite cool, A Noble Vision. It's very well acted,
Thank you so much. Very well produced.
Cinematography was cool. What would you say were any challenges with making this movie?
Well, the biggest challenge was the shooting schedule and the budget. What was most impressive to me about this production was I shot on location in Indianapolis for 2 weeks, and I shot 13 of 14 days. And to produce, shoot a feature film in that amount of time is quite a feat. Quite a feat. And it was great to have a local crew, a local cast, all come together and, you know, put the film together in such a short span of time with a limited budget. So that was the challenge, but also the triumph of this production.
Cool. And what made you or prompted you to take this film?
What prompted me to take the role? You know, it was a very complex character. I think that he was, you know, he has the noble vision, if you will. You know, he believes in something that is a bit outside the lines and out of the box. So the rebel's doctor was something that I thought I could have a lot of fun with. But then he's, you know, a bit of a romantic too, you know, which you don't really find in all doctors. You know, you don't find too many doctors that are writing and reciting poetry. So, you know, to pull that off, the rebel and the poet, I enjoyed playing those different colors.
Very cool. I just want to thank you for your performance, and hope you have much more success. And would you like to tell us anything else we can be looking out for you?
You know, I just returned to the stage. I just did a Shakespeare festival. So I always stay grounded and with my roots of theater. Nothing at the moment, but you never know.
We'll be looking out for it. And
absolutely.
Thank you, and congratulations.
Thank you. Oh, you know what? Sorry, I do have one. I have a film coming out. It's called Aftershock, the Nicole Bell story.
Oh, okay.
It should be on BET
sometime later this year.
Are you sure it'll be on BET or LNN?
I'm pretty sure. I don't know if we've fixed distribution yet, but that's where I've been told.
Okay. And how can people find you on social media?
MichaelRubenstone.com.
Cool. How about even on Twitter and Instagram?
I'm Unreal Guy on Instagram and Twitter, Michael Rubenstone.
Cool. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Maurice Duane Smith of Hollywood Times. I'm here with Dave Gibbons, the remarkable creator of Shape of My Eyes. And we're here to discuss that. It's a remarkable project that deals with many different topics, ranging from sorrow to pain to racism. And also see he's one of the last people that interviewed the great late Kobe Bryant. How's it going today, Dave?
Hey, you know, I'm pumped. We've been waiting for this day for like 4 years. Finally come.
Wow. Could you tell me why it took so long? Or were you just trying to make sure you got it correct?
Well, it's working with publishers. You know, you have to make sure that it's marketable, I guess. So we had to, you know, any artist knows you have to work with the institution to make sure it comes out not only to your liking, but their liking as well.
Mm-hmm. So now you're from Seoul, Korea?
Correct. I was born in Itaewon.
All right. You don't have any accent at all.
Yeah, no accent. My parents made sure of that. They were afraid that we wouldn't be able to assimilate if we had an accent.
Okay. Did you maintain the language, though?
Just the profanity and the food. That's it.
Now, could you tell us a little bit about some of the things that actually spurred you to create this project, such as I'm one of the people that society has chosen to, marginalize or, you know, throw racism at. So I know where you're coming from. But I'm not sure how it would be from your angle, although I do see a rising amount of racism coming at the Asian community. Would you like to elaborate on that and which of those events was most impactful that was the catalyst for this?
Yeah, I think there are several key events in this modern time for me.
Mm-hmm.
One was the pandemic, you know, because I went to an introverted state because I was already an introvert. And I love that time, to be honest, because mm-hmm. I was able to think more deeply about my life.
Right.
And then the George Floyd moment, when George Floyd was killed,
mm-hmm.
I was wrecked. And it made me think more about the racism that was happening in our country for the last 400 years, especially with the black community.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, you know what, I think it's important not only for the black community, but also the Asian American community,
mm-hmm.
kind of know about the racism that we've dealt with. And we haven't heard too many writers go deeply into that I've read, especially mm-hmm. from male authors. And so I said, man, I'm going to write my story.
Definitely. Yeah, actually, I think the media has chosen, or maybe has been reluctant to really show it and unveil the actual racism hurled at Asians, because you could have missed it if you weren't really a person that looks and, you know, seeks out knowledge. Because, there's bits and pieces, but some people tend to think that Asians don't get racism. Asians, for me once, I for some reason thought Asians never experienced homelessness or were poor. A lot of people have this idea that, you know, Asians are somehow non-marginalized and they're basically under the racism fence, so to speak. So I was kind of amazed when I had, you know, came into contact with some people that were Asian that, you know, when the 2008 deal hit and people just went under, mm-hmm. there are a lot of business guys who became homeless, and some were Chinese, some were Korean. And a lot of people don't believe that. So I think it's really important that this work comes out, and I'll be really, really anxious to see it. Is it mostly in a book, or is it also video as well?
It's in the book mostly, where I discuss it more in depth. You know, I have some talks I use as well.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you know, in terms of the Asian American thing, though, it's, you know, we've seen it happen last couple hundred years with Asian Americans. You know, with the Chinese, with the railway system they built,
mm-hmm.
the transcontinental railway system.
Mm-hmm.
And then also we've seen it with, like, the Japanese internment camps.
Right.
And then there was the Exclusion Act, where they didn't allow the immigration from Asia into America.
Mm-hmm.
So Asians have been facing racism this whole time,
mm-hmm.
you know, that I've been alive and with my ancestors as well. And so it just hasn't been talked about. And then the model minority myth that you mentioned,
mm-hmm.
it's interesting. It was really used against black people, you know, to try to pit us against one another to
right.
see like, hey, look at these model minority.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is, you know, we have a lot of Asians that struggle just as badly as anybody, as any people of color.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not talked about as much. In fact, right. Asians tend to be like the invisible minority group in America.
Mm-hmm.
Usually they talk about black, brown, but they don't talk about like the Asian community.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I feel this type of book is really critical to elevate the importance of Asian Americans on the rise. And you can see it happening globally, you know, from BTS, you know, the best-selling music group ever,
mm-hmm.
to now you see some of the best Hollywood movies are coming out of Korea.
Mm-hmm.
And also this place that we're now in was founded by Dan Lin, who made the Lego movie, he made The Departed, Sherlock Holmes,
mm.
the It series, The Two Popes, and recently they helped build the Avatar, The Last Airbender.
Amazing.
And then he just got promoted to Netflix as chairman of film and animation.
Wow.
So the Asian Americans on the rise, we normally don't see too much hype about it, but they're just quietly working vigilantly to do the best we can. But again, there's a whole gamut of people. We're not a monolith.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's different types of Asians. Even amongst Asians, you have like black and white,
mm-hmm.
where there's that type of hatred mm-hmm. amongst people who look alike.
Right. It's kind of, there's so much similarity between blacks, you know, I guess, and other races too, because mm-hmm. there's light-skinned blacks who have a problem with dark-skinned, vice versa, you know, and believe it or not, for the longest, blacks who felt that so-called pure-blooded blacks from Africa
right.
were different or strange and vice versa. So there's all this animosity coming from differences when, in my opinion, everybody should be, like everything else in science, attracted to the opposites. But getting back to what you said about people not knowing stuff, when I was in high school, there was a little talk about the internment camps, but strangely enough, when I went to a couple of colleges, not a drop talk.
No.
But it took me to go to Santa Monica College.
Yeah.
I was lucky enough to have a teacher who happened to have been ABC News correspondent.
Oh, gotcha.
And in fact, he did the Princess Diana story from Paris when she died.
Right on.
So he taught me stuff I'd never even heard about, from internment camps to the vicious nastiness during the railroad.
Yeah.
To actually a whole lot of stuff about Jews. I didn't know that
right.
when the war was over, they were just stuck out in the ocean and no one
yeah.
would let them in.
Yeah.
I was like, what, America did that?
Yep.
I was like, what?
Oh, yeah.
So he opened my eyes to a lot of stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I think this is very important for you to do. Now, is this going to be, knowing what I know now and what this whole organization is, how soon before it becomes a movie?
That's a good question. people are looking at it now, so we'll see what happens. I don't know. It'd be beyond my dreams if it did.
Well, I mean, your guy is right there from Netflix now. So you got a big N right there.
But, you know, I try not to manipulate it, you know, or use that as an advantage. But, yeah, we'll see.
Yeah, yeah. So now how would people, what's the most important aspect of your work and this knowledge that you want people to take from the work that you're presenting?
Yeah, you know, this book, The Shape of My Eyes, it's really written to those who are looking for home. I feel we have a generation of people that don't know where they belong.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's very tribal now. We're canceling each other. You know, even if there's a person of a different political persuasion, we don't know how to be civil,
mm-hmm.
respect one another.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to try to create a home by this vision of my story, of how do we do this when you had people that were very different from one another. So my prayer is that it be a book that helps inspire hope and healing.
Very good. Now, one of the last things I want to ask you, and a lot of people look at me like I'm a heretic, but I have to ask this question.
Yeah, man.
Because I think I'm one of the few people who think about it.
Yeah.
I keep hearing that the nation's so divided
yeah.
now, and I'm like, well, it looks like the same thing to me
it
that's been
works.
Going on.
Yeah.
The only thing now is
exposed.
There's political rhetoric
yeah.
to try to control
totally.
People.
Totally.
And it's like, why can't anyone see that but me? I can't be that smart. Yeah. Can't be.
No, no.
But you know what I'm saying, right?
No, you're right. It was always there.
It's always there.
It's just being more visible. It's more blatant right now.
Right.
I think Trump helped inspire that, was catalytic when he just tells it like it is. But, you know, to me, it's a frightening moment, though, you know, in the sense that it's out there, but it's kind of ugly.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's important that people see how ugly it is.
Mm-hmm.
I read a stat, man, that it said right now, 12 million people are willing to resort to violence if their candidate's not elected.
I know, that is... That now that is different.
Yeah, that's different. Know? That's 4.4% of the American population.
Yeah, yeah.
That's crazy.
But I think that only came about, just like you said, that people feel that they can get away with it. They're more emboldened now to voice their racism, whereas before they shake your hand.
Exactly. Act like they
and
love
then
you.
Talk under the you freaking nigga.
Exactly.
You know, you're
exactly.
freaking this and that. But now they're like, they do it. They have a circle. They have a demographic to belong to.
Sure.
They're positively reinforced for doing it.
Yeah.
You know, so,
no,
but I'm glad if nothing else happens today, I found someone that believes like I believe.
Right on.
It's always been divided.
It's always been there.
It's never been different.
And again, the black community has been facing for 400 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so we, you know, so I honor, like any type of civil rights I enjoy today
mm-hmm.
is because of my black brothers and sisters who fought for me.
Yeah, thank you so much. But you guys are coming in there, tearing the door down too, because I've seen some groups, Asian groups, I can't remember quite the name, where it says Asians for Blacks or Asians against Black racism. So there's
oh yeah,
there's a lot of
we're allies.
But like you said, some people want us to be against each other.
Oh yeah,
they don't want cohesion whatsoever.
No, we stand together.
Yeah.
A lot of my Asian American community, we're standing with you.
And the very last thing I want to ask you about, now I actually had a brief discussion with Kobe.
Yeah.
Years ago when he was in his 20s.
Right on.
But believe it or not, it wasn't about anything other than just amino acids.
Yeah, right.
I was telling him, you know, you're real young, you got that teen spirit going on, but if you hooked up your knowledge with your genetic persuasion and learned about aminos and branched chain aminos, you know, no, I just want to keep everything natural.
Yeah.
I'm like, this is natural. You just, once you find out, you're opening up a freaking whole new dimension.
Sure.
So I think he did it because, I don't know, but I just think that his game changed. He became stronger, much more durable, especially during the last quarters, than his counterparts. They'd be standing around pretending not to be winded, and he'd still be coming. But I can't take credit for it. But that was what he and I spoke about. We spoke about aminos.
I see. The L-arginine. Physical aspect of his body.
Yeah, we spoke about... COQ10, none of these he was aware of. And even his trainer from the Lakers, he didn't know about it.
Yeah, yeah, right. Well, that's great that you had a conversation with him about that.
Yeah, that was
our conversation was more about, like, his values,
mm-hmm.
how he was changing as a man, and
mm-hmm.
as a father and husband,
mm-hmm.
and as a player. He was shifting careers at the time, right before he died. We were looking to partner together, our company possibly, with his company.
Wow.
So we had this private meeting with him.
Mm-hmm.
And so I asked him some questions, we interviewed him, and he said, you know, first of all, he felt like he wants to focus more upon being a good dad.
Mm.
So he said he had his competitive edge came out, where he said, you know how people line up to pick up their kids?
Mm-hmm.
He said he wanted to be the first one to pick up his children. So he says that was his goal, every day to beat this one person.
Wow.
And so that was beautiful to me. He said he wanted to be there for his kids when they came home. He wanted to pick them up. So I could see how he's changed as a dad.
Mm-hmm.
Then I also saw how he's moving his talent into artistry.
Yeah.
Into different types of art. So that's why he went to make children's films.
Mm-hmm.
And he had just come out with his children's books.
That's incredible.
And so I loved how he was reshifted. But even in terms of his character, where he said he was sad that he wasn't more like a better teammate when he was playing with the Lakers. He said he should have listened more and paid more attention to his team. So I thought, man, this guy is growing.
Yeah.
And he's willing to admit it.
That's cool, yeah. That whole new metamorphosis. But I interviewed his dad also.
Yeah, right.
And I was told, don't talk too much about his dad. Kobe to his father, at the time they had some sort of estrangement.
And yeah, yeah.
They weren't that close at the time when he was the coach for the LA Sparks. But, you know, he was cool. But I just wish that I could have, you know, found a way to get them together, whatever. But I got a feeling that they hooked it up towards the end. But I just want to thank you for inviting me out here. This is going to be fantastic. Because I didn't really look at what it was about until I got into the boba.
Oh, yeah, boba guys?
I was sweating my brains out, and I couldn't get that front door open. So I was like, let me go over here and get a boba. And I started looking. I was like, oh, okay, shaping my eyes. All right, okay.
Yeah, it's a memoir on race, faith, and finding myself.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people are just trying to figure out, like, who they are.
Actually, sometimes it takes way into your 50s, 60s, and 70s.
I know.
80s.
I know. That's why, to me, I wanted to tell the story. I felt maybe this could help some people to process it more quickly.
Mm-hmm. I think you're doing great work, and just keep up the good work. And I'm looking to read it, and I'm looking to see it become a film or some sort of weekly deal on Netflix.
Thanks, my brother.
Thank you so
much.
Appreciate
that.
Take care.
Yep. Right on.
Bye bye. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here with the former Sax Fair Cool and the Gang here at George Brown's son's house. We're about to check out his live concert, and we just really absorbed some of George's music. Could you tell us a little bit about yourself? How long you played for Cool and the Gang?
My name is Louis Van Zander. I was hired to play with Cool and the Gang in the fall of 1996, I met J.T. Taylor while I was a member of the Gap Band. We happened to do a joint concert. The Gap Band was opening up for Cool and the Gang. And so it happened I was very fortunate to be there. They liked the way I played. And the regular other founding member, Khalees Bayon, sometimes wouldn't go out on the road, so they needed a tenor saxophone player to play the gigs that he wasn't on the road on. So I got hired, and I played with the band from December 96 to February 1998, and then I rejoined the band around 2010. And then just recently left the band in August 15th of 2023. Love playing with Cool and the Gang. I've had the honor of working with the great George Brown on so many projects. George was not only a friend, but he was this, I wouldn't call him a mentor, but I call him someone that just, you know, really helped me improve my recording technique. And it's an absolute honor to be on his last project.
Oh, that's cool. That's amazing. Could you tell me something? I think you might know someone that I know. Do you know Victor Orlando?
I know Victor Orlando. He's Jala.
Yeah. I do an online TV show, and he came on there a couple of times. And so we've been friends for about 6-7 years. Small world.
It's small world. He's a fantastic musician, and he's a very serious entrepreneur.
Does a serious Richard Pryor too.
Yeah, he's a bad man.
So I just want to thank you for your time.
And thank you.
Congratulations on your fantastic talent.
Thank you,
and what
sir.
You've done for music.
My pleasure. I hope everyone buys this product or streams it, and certainly will enjoy it.
Thank you so much. Well, were you on any of those songs that we heard?
All the songs that had saxophone solos, from tenor sax to alto sax, even soprano sax, that is me playing.
Wow. Get on down.
Get on down.
With your bad song.
Hello.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Put your ones up. Everybody in the house, put your ones up. Put your ones up.